Welcome back, everybody, here to your coverage of the RaidCall EMS One Fall season as we're doing Group Stage C right now with Mousesports going up against Team Property. Mousesports already with a commanding one-game lead. Let's see if they can extend it any further, because if they take both these games right now, well, they will advance themselves through into tomorrow's matchup where they'll face up against the winner of the other semi-final, and that'll be the playoff to see who goes to the LAN final. Mousesports were there last time. In fact, they were the victors last time. Very, very different roster to what they have now. But they are still the brand of the team is the defending champions here. So, Crystal Maiden and Batrider, the pickups here from Property. So they get the CM. I saw Ryze also tweeting out in the break that he just loves that Crystal Maiden. And it really is. It's a powerful, powerful hero. Mousesports, they go with the Clockwork and the Visage. So Clockwork banned out in the last game. This time around, though, we'll see who gets to play it. We will still see. Like, Link's puck was always a very, very good puck. We'll see if his Clockwork is up to scratch as well. Visage being picked up, so we get our nice nuking hero. A great hero to have up against the Crystal Maiden. Like, you had Chen last time up against the Crystal Maiden, and Crystal Maiden will always come out on top during that matchup. But now you get a very high nukage and harassment of birds. Crystal Maiden can't control those birds and doesn't have the damage to get rid of it. I believe, actually, what was our other one? It wasn't Silencer, was it? Oh, I'm trying to remember. Honey and I found the perfect count of Visage's birds the other day. And it's not just OD. OD is definitely one of the good ones, but there was another one, which is not coming to mind right now. But we do have OD banned out. Reserve time. Naga as well. Ryze not taking any chances. He takes out both the Whisper as well as the Elder Titan. They weren't going to pick it up themselves. And this is what I was talking about during game number one. There's just so many other heroes that you want to take out in these early stages. The Batrider is able to slip through. Like, even in our last game, the man who was always being picked up, because he was this combination with be it concoctions or be it with any kind of AoE kind of damage, the Darkseer was completely avoided during the last game, and in this game too, like, hasn't been touched. We ban out the Prophet. Again, we look towards that jumping around the map kind of a nuisance. They take out the Weaver. Funny enough, they removed the Weaver in this scenario when the Weaver isn't majorly the problem, because you got Frostbite as well as having Batrider with Lasso, which means Mousesports can just go in for a Lifestealer. Lifestealer obviously can be controller, but his biggest problem in the last game was actually the Puck. Silencing him up and making it so he couldn't get himself into the rage. And then you want to follow up with a Frostbite. Then you got yourself some good combinations. But if you don't get the very, very start, you're just rage free of the shackles. And you're looking very, very good as a Lifestealer then. And we'll see if Mousesports want to try it. We're going to get... Yay! Yay! Ryze Enchantress! This guy in, like... I don't know if there is a percentage. I don't know if DOTA even has this. I don't know if DOTA is still up, so if our stat man could find it. But I would like to have a gander and say it would be roughly about 80% of Enchantresses played by Ryze are aggressive. And I'm saying aggressive as in he goes to the enemy jungle. I don't know if that could even be worked out. But yeah, the Enchantress picked up after the Chen being banned out as well. So there's only one more jungle option, the Team Property. Well, there's actually a couple, but the only primary one would be the Enigma. There's still the possibility of running Axe in the jungle, but up against Clockwork, Visage, and Enchantress, maybe not so great. Yeah, so Figgleet, gonna go with the Troll Warlord. Not gonna pass up on a good thing. But at the same time, Troll Warlord is one of like these double-edged style heroes. Like, Crystal Maiden and Batrider don't get massively buffed up by having the Battle Trance. Having heroes like a Weaver or a Lifestealer, hell yeah, they love it. They love it to bits. But with a Troll Warlord, like, you get a Lifestealer raging up, and you open wounds him up, where's your escape mechanism? You don't really have one. Your mischance is your biggest escape mechanism available for the Troll Warlord. And then where do you transition into it? It's like, you got to run him on that middle lane, just so he becomes this support that rotates around and tries to split the fights up by just being so powerful. But apart from that, he doesn't really bring that much more to the team. You have quick Roshans and you have other things like this, but yeah, all these different things that can combine up. But you need the combinations to make it really work. So, Ryze, I don't see him passing up the Lifestealer here. And I say that for two reasons. One, because it still works for their lineup. It works for an aggressive tri-lane. Enchantress and Visage are already going to be very, very aggressive on that bottom lane. Unless they plan different things, but both Enchantress and Visage are supports. There's only one time. Ooh. Radiant team different pick. Things. We're going to go with DOTA. We're going to get ourselves a DOTA. Now, this is interesting. This is very, very interesting. Batrider hates DOTA. Absolutely hates DOTA. Gets Eraldi off. Life is really, really hard. Everybody turns to stone. And Enchantress then just loves that. Remaining. She'll have all the space in the world. DOTA will also have the extra heal all come from the Enchantress. Clockwork. He's going to have himself a fruit lane on top. This is going to be Clockwork versus Batrider on top. That's a perfectly good matchup for the Clockwork. In fact, I kind of almost want that Troll Warlord to switch to bottom. So we see Troll on bottom with the Crystal Maiden and pick up something that can... You can't really hold the DOTA in position. I guess you could use a Fiend script, but... Yeah, okay, Nyx actually better. So we get Mana Burn, we get Initiation. I like this from Frigolite. Also with the Spike Carapace gives him opportunities to, well, just escape from the Visage and the Enchantress, and possibly even the Clockwork to some extent. Lifestealer still hasn't been touched. Mousesports, they need a mid-solo here, and they're going to ban out the Anti-Mage, in fact. So they're saying that Troll Warlord's going to be in mid, Batrider's going to be in the offlane. If Lifestealer's on the bottom here with the Nyx and the Crystal Maiden, obviously you got too many melee heroes there. But with the Anti-Mage feel, that's a lot of confidence to say. I suppose you can also just throw this one out there. The Clockwork could still be in the middle lane. There's still an option available too. Some high level six and some quick rotations could work. Reserve time. And Frigolite. He's got one last ban to do. It's really hard to ban out against that middle lane though. Like, what will they even go? We saw Razors in our past game. They're going to take out the puck. So they take out the possibility of the puck mid. Even up against a Troll Warlord, I'm wondering if you even just consider running DOTA as a solo in that middle lane. Free levels. It's got some good harassment to keep Troll Warlord back. And you got a lot of survivability as well coming out. So Ryze now. Last selection. Lay it on me, man. Lay it on me. You've already got the DOTA. Is she going to be in the aggressive tri lane, or do we mix things up a little bit more here? Reserve time. I suppose you still want to have someone that can go up against the Batrider mid if things do get rough. They could just look towards the Razor again. There's no reason why they can't. Crystal Maiden and Nyx could cause some issues, but at the same time, it wouldn't be too many issues for the Razor. But there's so many different options you could run over that middle lane. See, an old classic, Queen of Pain, Cinderin's old little fella. Or young, wonderful, bodacious woman. But Ryze has to come to a decision anyway. 22 seconds left on the clock. And then Property can decide how they want to approach this. Because their lanes are still pretty much open. Both Troll and Bat can go middle lane. And they're going to go with a DK. So, Radiant team. DK, good hero up against a Batrider. Good hero up against a Troll Warlord. It's a stable pickup, which means DOTA, give us your long laner. I hope she doesn't just get greedy and go safe lane. Because if that happens, then we'll have very passive lanes to start with. Which isn't what Property want. In fact, it may even be better for Mousesports to do that. Because you're running up against a Nyx as well as a Crystal Maiden. If you don't get control of that jungle very early on, like I'm talking like a five-man movement from Mousesports, then they're not going to get control of the bottom lane. But if they get control of the bottom lane, they snowball. That's the power of getting control of that bottom lane. But that top lane, yeah. That's going to be one of those things that they could go safe. And they're going to go with an SF here. So it will be Batrider on the off lane. There is no doubt about this right now. Phloxbox take the Troll Warlord, and then you've got the SF in there. It also looks like DOTA 2 just got patched. Now, I don't know if it is the 6.79 information, because if it is, our next game will be on 6.79. Just a warning. Just a warning, because I don't believe they'll make it, so the tournament version is going to be different. They haven't done that for a while now. So, yeah, keep your eyes peeled for that. Keep your eyes most definitely peeled for that one. I know, the boys are searching for the JD staff to make sure they know what the hell's going on.
5 seconds remaining.
All right, so Syndrant, DK middle, Link, in fact, taking up the Medusa, which means if they want to, we could have that aggressive tri lane, just not with Link. And Link E is going to head up north. So yeah, this is something which I kind of feared was going to happen, but it's also the right decision to make for Mousesports, because they're not pressured to go on aggressive tri lane, but the Nyx and the Crystal Maiden are pressured to make their purpose known on this map. Like, you only got one Clarity over on a Crystal Maiden right now. That's not enough for just to, like, pull up this little camp here and stack it and farm it and just do all that kind of jazz. Link wants to farm. He doesn't want to be involved in an aggressive tri lane from the very, very start unless he knows they'll get the upper hand. So they just protect their own jungle. Syndrome will take that DK to the middle lane. No pulled tangos. It's just his own set of tangos, so he'll get a bottle up later. And then up towards our top lane. Link, rise and crit. All together. Together forever. And they'll be babysitting up on the top. Oh, will they? They haven't moved down. Have the lines been drawn to go down south? There's no aggressive tri lane from prop up here. And Ace is moving down there as well. They could leave Link up on the top lane, which means Ryze and Crit can rotate around and still try and contest the bottom jungle. But that's going to be a lot of confidence. And Ryze, he won't move until he gets a creep from here. He already knows they control their own jungle, so that's fine for him. And Crit's going to find a regeneration rune, so the rune which will make no difference whatsoever to any lanes being picked up. And they'll just wait for the 2-minute rune now. That's Dev style. Good ward just a little bit later, so 10 seconds after the rune spawns. Means they'll be able to see that 6-minute rune as well before that ward will time out. We'll have Phlox in the middle lane. Syndrome up against him. Ace in a position where he's blocked up two of the melee creeps now. There's only a small creep wave coming down here from CYSO. But Steph Style's going to be right on top of keeping this lane in check. Like, Frigolite's already starting his pull to farm. So Frostbite over on the Dark Troll Warlord Summoner. It's just very easy to get CS at level 1 as a Crystal Maiden. See how long that Frostbite just lasts for on the creeps. 1.5 seconds is the timer. That seems a little bit longer. Now, CYSO. Actually being kept away from the creep wave. Ace got denied up as many of these things as possible. Because the more CS you see in the asset, the more powerful it gets. This is just the way he works. It is just the way he works. Alright, so I also, it was confirmed. The update that came tonight is coming with the changes. I've just received the data that it has, it includes a 6.79. The update which just got released. Which means our next matchup, Power Rangers up against Empire. If Mousesports take this, if not, we go for a third game. This next matchup will be on 6.79, peoples. And pull out your notepads and all your books. We'll be going into analyst mode. Ace backing himself up. Also remember the changes to a lot of the different heroes. I'm going to have this thing as a reference sheet over on my side. Cinderin. Whirling Axe doesn't make life easy here, but at the same time, he doesn't need a right click to get last hits. He is being completely out CS. Now the shoe is most definitely on the other foot. Syndrome is well behind this. We've got a stun out by Steph Style, but Ryze has come down here too. Battery Assault, the Cogs will be there too. Grave Chill now be used, realizing the Cogs are going to go down. Crit keeps the attack going, and this will be First Blood. Steph Style killed off by Crit. SF's trying to get closer to bring down Ace, but he's using level 2 raises to try and get in the damage. And it's not going to be enough. Get rid of this last little creep, Frigolite. He's also in rather close, and if these Cogs manage to latch up, oh man, SF! He really overstayed his welcome, and now the Cogs, they catch Frigolite! We've already got that clarity going to work. They don't even need the Soul Assumption. It's going to be Ace with a double kill on this offlane. Again, Mousesports. Their offlane is beautiful. They mix it up.
Under attack.
They have the Enchantress and the CM rotate down, but they already knew the power of this. It's a really good stack for the Batrider. And Ryze, he doesn't body block it, but he can see it. steals the Wild Wing, and I think I know what he wants to do. He wants to push this little sucker up and just tornado. Split up as well the pull. But if he gets the tornado off before the napalm and everything else can go to work, he's going to take a couple of these creeps out here. I don't know if they'll really try and contest that, because that's a really good stack. And Frigolid's coming out to try and stop it. Steph Style as well, and Ryan's going to back himself out. So the stack will end up going the way of Werner, which is very much needed for him. It's like on bottom lane, more fun to be had with COESO. Locked in there with Ace. He's still got another two raises. Got to time it right. If he gets both these, he should have him. One raise, second raise. Bottle charges in between the attacks here, Ace. And you can see him. He's going from side to side, trying to avoid that raise at all costs. And he's able to do so. Ryze and Crit can't rotate up because, again, we've got these rotating, this rotating Crystal Maiden as well as Nyx Assassin. That's making life very difficult. And DK, Syndrome, get some double figures in CS, man. You got a DD rune at 2 minutes now. You'll pick up an illusion rune as well at 4 minutes after having the regeneration rune tonight, the first. But this DK is not having a good time up against a troll. 26 for 14. So Syndrome's also being denied up the experience as well. And it's off. And Nick's just waiting for a stun time. If Ace comes down far enough here, he just gets to cross this line. If he crosses this line, then Steph Style has enough time. Moving over the side, even with the boots, I'll maybe have to rework that line a little bit, but it should be okay. Batrider's now up on the top lane, making life a little bit more difficult for Link, but Crit, there's your Grave Chill. Sada Blast as well coming out from the jungle creeps, and the Soul Assumption damage, that's not going to be enough. Not enough damage was taken. So not enough charge has been built up for it. Syndrome now 13, but that troll is 31 for 14. With the PMS first, he has dominated this middle lane. SF's also not doing too bad. 17 for 12. More importantly for him, he's got his souls up. He's got one death to his name, obviously not great, but he's also got a kill directly after, so you're looking on the bright side of some things. Ace in very, very close. The cog's already up, but Ace being stunned up and held in position. Steph Star, the Nyx Assassin, the Spy Carapace. Another thing which will actually change in the new version, that won't kill him. They changed it so the target that does the damage gets the effect of the Spire Carapace, not the hero that it came from. It's the thing with the illusions too. Like if you pop an illusion rune, that was one of the changes. So it also reworks the cog. Syndrome now looking for some sweet ass revenge. He doesn't have mana for a brief fire though, so he can't get this kill. He's really overcommitted himself. A lasso is worth it. Just drag him back. Hold him in position so Phloxbox can go again. No Whirling Axe for now. Shadow Blast comes in to help out from the Enchantress, but it's a little bit too late. So Syndrome losing CS in the middle lane, losing his life points as well. And Link as well as Crit will now push out the top. While Steph Style locked in with Ace SF, he's moving up. He's now got his fourth level up in raises. So one raise, second raise, and he's got, he doesn't even need the second raise. Got the further buff up. They lose the Nyx Assassin, but SF gets another kill. Now this match is going the way of property. 500 gold their way. Experience coming up as well. They do still have that problem of Ryze inside the jungle. He's moving through rather quickly, even though he has been dedicating a lot of creeps to helping out that middle lane or moving around the bottom. But having Werner inside the jungle, stacking up, farming up, that sentry wall from the Radiant side, it'll disappear. Can't look close enough to block up that camp. But this is looking really good. They got SF with farm, who's now, after his first death, got two kills to his name. Crystal Maiden, only level 3, but that's okay. She gives what she needs to. And the big player still in the lineup here for Mousesports is this Medusa. Going 4-level Mystic Snake, as well as the 3-level up in the Mana Shield.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
With all the farm she's got, I'm wondering if she kind of wish she got split shot at this point. Ace. Another thing to change around. These neutral creeps, when they die, they split their experience. So all that experience then would have been equal between Steph Style as well as Ace, whoever stayed closer had that. Ryan's going to go for a smoke movement with double centaurs. That centaur's only got another 19 seconds left to live. So they've got to move quickly into this middle, and quickly is like right now. Like turn, Syndarin's already in trouble. Lasso trying to drag him back. The Grave Chill is out right now, slowing down the Troll Warlord, and Syndarin, he's actually going to stay alive through all of this. And they're going to kill on the Troll Warlord. I can't stress how much that was needed for Syndarin. He still has to walk all the way back to base to heal, and he brought up his treads before he thought he was going to die here. But that was so needed, that counter gank as well. Because it's wasted time for the supports. It's Troll Warlord going down. It's the last two back on cooldown for a little bit. And the Enchantress has rotated down as well with the Visage. They've only got one Centaur to their name, so Ryze, in fact, now steals an Alpha Wolf. So they get bonus damage down here. Not really a huge thing for this lineup, because they don't have their damage shield with them unless Medusa wants to TP to the bottom lane. But at this point, Link, there's no reason for him to leave that top lane. Link's also one of those players that he's quite happy to sit there and farm. The amount of times I have seen him play like a brute mother, another hero too. Expect to be first ban. Actually, no. She's out. She's not in captain's mode. She's not in captain's mode. I take it back. But seriously, broken. Basically, I know there was actually a guy that debated this as well inside of a chat, saying like, why do you complain about brute mother when Batrider's been doing the same thing for ages? I'm like, no, I was complaining about the Batrider as well. The fact that you can move outside the map to a place where you cannot be attacked. I think it's just the FPS blood inside of me that looks at that and just says it's a glitch. Because the old FPS, whenever we try to find glitches, it was if you can attack somebody and they can't attack you, you have an advantage position where someone else cannot reach, then it's a glitch. Yeah. So it kind of feels like. Whoop, Courier. Versace's Familiar is already on the hunt for that little sucker. Right, that lobster into the tree line into safety. And the Satyrs are coming in too, so they could try and keep tabs on what's going on. And Ace also moving down. Do it with flair. Clockwork misses the hook. It was pretty damn close, that SF. But look at the Familiar damage. One drop, two drops, and now also with a battery assault. Shadow Fiend is just a death ollie which comes off. Crit with the Grave Chill as well. Going to focus on Freak Elite, who now flocks. Is going to give some cover fire too. Coming in with a Whirling Axe. Crit will actually die. The creep wave that's here. And Ryan is popping off the heal. It's too little, too late. They've already got the slow from the Troll Warlord range axes. And now in close, Whirling Axes too. Need an extra bash. Actually, they don't need one. They got Napalm, and they're going to use the Nyx stun to boot. 3 euros lost. DK also dying in the middle lane at the same time to all of this. Rockets was searching for the kill on the Crystal Maiden, but the Visage Familiars actually pick off that Crystal Maiden. Speaking of picking off, now the Batrider is a Blink Dagger. One last stack to farm. Radiant's top tower is under attack. Doesn't really have a lot of Napalm charges to do this, however. He's got 2 Napalms and then the Firefly. So he's going to start it off with the Firefly and then go into it. He's going to get 3 off. With his mana regeneration, he'll get 3. So some decent money. Ace looking for another hook shot. 1 second till it comes off cooldown. Crit's already used 1 Familiar now. 2 Familiar stuns. Battery Assault going up next. Still got the hook shot here, Ace. With the Soul Assumption damage, he's going to have to use it. Frostbite. Oh, no! Crit will still get the kill, however. But Ace hook-shotting into the Familiars. We still have Link free farming top. And there hasn't been a single hero to contest him. Now Troll Warlord comes top, and that's probably the only player that can probably stand up against this this Medusa solo. That are of the Squiddish family. Visage. Now with Gem. Really? Hang on. We're gonna lasso timing on Ryze. Mana burn as well. So when Ryze getting caught out. DK is rotating down, getting Frost Nova'd up a little bit. Wernay's here as well. Mr. Blink Dagger trying to steer clear. In fact, double taps to Blink. And where did he end up running to? He jumped up, which means Steph Style's all alone here. Spy Carapace won't save him from the Soul Assumption damage coming out. And DK, in his dragon form, Syndrome's able to pick off that kill. And Wernay, he blinked up and then smoked away to safety. We got Link. First time he comes off that lane. Comes into the middle. Just tappy McTap-tap. We get 5 man Dota time for Mousesports. Link's only got 1 level up on the ulti, but who really cares? Crit brings the birds up, and look at the damage to the tower. With the dragon poison as well, that thing's just ticking itself out. Are you still looking for a hook shot down? Can't find one properly yet, though. And if Ryze can find one tanky creep, then they could... Whoa, 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 miss your gem. Where did our gem run off to? It should be in the hands of the Visage. Yeah, it's a long way away. Now, probably, they're doing... Well, there's only four men, Dota, though. Fortification were used by the Dire side. While up on the top lane, Werner is the one who's out of position. Up there by himself. They did bring Cinder and Ace back to the middle lane to defend. Looks like bottom lane Linkley's going to take care of this bottom tower. This just turns into trades again. They get Illusion Rune bolted up. Cinderin's taking almost every single rune. Actually, the TP comes up from Ace. So he's already popped up the rocket. Now he's going to get Cogs up. Too late. Blink Lanasu. I'm not quite sure what Ace thought he could do up here by himself, but now there's going to be two TPs coming up. They're committing to this. Naga's the first one to come in. Now goes into that ultimate, and everybody, may you turn to stone and never walk again. Stun up from DK. The stun returned up by Nyx Assassin to Link Link, and Sevstar comes in with a Vendetta just to get that final hit in. Enchantress with the Impetus into Phlox Phlox. Syndrome again able to get the last hits out of all of this. But a lot of the damage being dealt out by the Impetus as well as Crit Soul Assumption and Sevstar. There's no real way out. This Spy Camera's going to try and protect him. They need the extra stun, and in fact, it's just tanked up. Visage will get this kill. The Dragon Tail able to be used at the end of the day. Stop that TP out to safety. And Mousesports hold all their towers. I remember actually one of those changes was the fact they made it so that the Black Dragons, the Dragons in the neutral camps, they no longer have flying. It just made the pull on the bottom lane way too easy. Like, way, way too easy. Even to a point, I believe, you could actually pull it so you'd take the aggro from the top lane on the Radiant side. Clockwork attempting a latch on the Crystal Maiden. That's a level 1 hook, though, so too short for Ace. Puts it back onto cooldown now. He's going to just move himself over towards the pit. They've got the Hellbear, which should be moving in there for Enchantress. Tank it up. Yep, Ryze will come in too. He's still got his heal, but doesn't probably want to waste the mana. While they got Untouchable, it's also not really essential. The pings are coming out. The Roshan is definitely going on. And it's a very obvious thing. Like, the Observer Ward went down. Ace saw it going down because they had their own Observer Ward that was scouting out for that movement. There goes your top tower. But this is meant to be worth it. Keep him slowed up. That Hellbear's back in a timeout. Ryze shouldn't be tanking this up instead of laying the Hellbear, but oh well. Crit also bringing a medallion. It's like a negative armor and Link Link with the Untouchable. That's just so much slow. Link now is the full Lincoln Sphere as well as an Aegis to the Immortal. It's a very, very fat... I keep wanting to say Nagasaren. It's Medusa. But 4,000 gold going the way Clockwork. Well, missed the latch, now he's going to be in trouble. Lasso goes on Link Link. They want him dead because the Linkosphere hasn't arrived just yet. It'll fly in now, but the Aegis Immortal's already triggered. In fact, the Linkosphere, it can't deliver to something that's dead. But it will now come in. So they get the kill out in Link Link, but they use their Lasso. They use the Troll ulti. SF doesn't have mana for his ultimate right now, which is a very, very big issue. The Shadowblade up for Troll. Warlord, he's looking for an opening on Mousesports. He really does have it. Ace doesn't have his hookshot available. Naga's just trying to harass back with the Mystic Snake, not making life easy for that Crystal Maiden. And the push will come to the tier 2. TP back from the top lane. Everybody's come back for the extra mana. And this is the time where Property kind of do have to fight this. Like, it's still only the basic Lincoln Sphere up on the Medusa. Not a lot of life points, only 1,000. Mana pool also not really that high for her. So, it is the time to try this. Enchantress already getting one. Ace being stunned up a little bit. That was from the Nyx stun. What else got from Ace? He's got 15 wand charges available for himself. Well, there's 10 sticks over on Link Link. And they're rotating down to the tier 2 tower in the bottom lane. And it was rightly pinged out. Got an invis rune sitting on bottom lane for Mousesports. If they do want to pick it up, while Batrider hunting familiars, but I think more importantly, hunting heroes. Jumping in very, very deep here. Familiars don't really care about that Firefly. Yeah, it's one of those things where you don't have a quick and easy pick off against the familiars. SF kind of does with his large amount of damage. He can get rid of those guys pretty quickly. But kind of also needs to be able to stand during the fights. He better once he has that BKB up and running, then no more familiar stuns to really make life hard. Double invis, Shadow Blade, as well as the Vendetta. And Clockwork, he tried a blind attack. Already brought down one familiar, and they're chasing down the Troll Warlord. Nova off from Frigolite in the side. They still can't get close enough to him, weren't they? Blink comes off cooldown, but he's already used most of his Firefly, so he doesn't want to do that. And Cinder is the solo defender here on the middle lane. And he'll have to let the tier 1 tower go.
Dire's middle tower has fallen.
And the damage from SF is just a little bit too scary for him. So the second tower now going the way of property. And with a full BKB now purchased up by Cinderin, you know, both the SF and the DK with BKBs in the next fight. So that should be the BKB. Yeah, there's a recipe on the courier. And a 4-star recipe to boot. That one will be long over to the Batrider. He still needs just a small ring. And he'll be good to go. Again, this Firefly have been used offensively. So he's not good to fight. Cinderin into his Flame Dragon form. That BKB's almost arrived. And this tower belongs to Mousesports. Again, property will not be able to defend another tier 2 tower. They're held out. And the attempt for a kill isn't coming. Like, they got 2 points of invis now. This is what I was kind of talking about with the Troll Warlord. Like, what does he bring to the fight? Is he coming in there to look for a straight-up stun? Like, what's the plan here for the Troll Warlord? You're going to go with the Whirling Axes into a Shadow Blade. It's good initiation, but it comes through Whirling Axes, slowing them down as well. But put yourself in a lot of jeopardy. And now he's going to build into a BKB, so at least he can fight once he gets in there. Werner, looking for one. He's going to find crit. Lasso over on crit. Familiars are right behind him. 4-star already being used. Now into the Whirling Axes. This should be the death of crit. And there's an expensive death too. The gems on the deck. Picked up, in fact, by the Nyx Assassin. BKB up from the SF so he can stand this fight. He's going to wind up the ulti. But Link Link has already slowed everybody else down with his own ultimate. Ace around the corner. DK with a stun, SSBKB wore off, and now Cinderin will pop his own. They won't be able to stop him from doing this little bit of a charge. Breathe fire, he walks the wrong, actually no, he doesn't walk the wrong way. He's walking away from Flox Blocks. Now turns, he's got the Dragon Tail stun. Breathe fire, Enchantress with the Impetus, but double raises from CYSO able to connect, and then TB's himself back into the base. And away to safety, Stepstyle also retreating out. Great fight for property. They bounced Mousesports around then. The initiation from Batrider, while risky, and still ended up working for him. The advantage, of course, overall is the way of Mousesports. With that fight, the experience advantage isn't really that different. And most of that's just tower gold. Because you've got the advantage of 3 towers going the way of Mousesports right now. 2 tier 2s and 1 tier 1 is their advantage. Their other big advantage is the fact that net worth, yeah, 10,000 is up for the Dusa. And then you got 8.1k for the SF. TP's up to top. Cinderin gonna chill up here for the moment. Looks over towards crit. CYSO just tries to get himself back into that high level of farm. I say back, he's already finished up his BKB and now he'll be building into, I hope, some kind of damage dealing item. I'm almost hoping a Desolator, because he's going up against a DK. I wouldn't blame him if he tries to go for like Crystallis in this game. Firefly with a Haste Rune too, very defensive, sporadically spread. Link being bounced in range of the tower. Denial attempt, not going to come. Medusa will get the last hit out. That's the last remaining out of tower for property gone. And Medusa also the possibility, if she wants to, after she farms up this bottom lane, to pick up a full SMY. Possibly looking at the Mana Star though. A Mana Star will probably be the higher choice here. Could just be a casual Yasha too and go into Ascardi. Always a great item. But do we get the ultimate orb? Get a TP scroll. Alright. I'm just wondering how Link wants to build this Medusa. Yeah, Amanda style it will be. I highly doubt he's going to get the ultimate orb and not build into that Amanda style and then also not get a Scotty. Like, to get the Scotty instead of the Amanda style. Not going to happen. Steph style on the run. Vendetta going to be used. Going to move him up and finds Ace. Observable was already spotting this one out. And there goes Ace. DK wants to follow up something. They're going to try and find this one, Mousesports. The Enchantress creeps are coming in, and well, DK's already popped. If he popped up the BKB, it would be a full commitment from Mousesports just then. It becomes a semi-commitment with the DK form. But another snipe off. They find the clockwork. For some reason, was throwing out his cogs just around here. Maybe feeling a little bit under pressure. Is that also a courier? No recipe on the courier. But he is a rather cute little guy. Mr. Penguin. Those little balloons. Cinderin's going to get himself another rune now. A DK with an invis. Still got Dragon Form for a short amount of time, but up on the top lane, we got Werne. They saw him. Troll Warlord's running up. A blink to Lasso. Lasso on cooldown. 4 more seconds, though, and they've got it off cooldown. Don't know if they really want to do it anyway. Let's see how the Familiar's in here. And Werne just lost his Firefly. 4 staffs up. Flame Break. Try and push him back. But Cinder is now going to make his way in. Invis Rune. Stun to Werne with a Breathe Fire too. In fact, it should be very, very lucky for the Troll Warlord. He didn't get caught out by that Breathe Fire as well. Link on the bottom lane. Oh, we got a little Centaur coming in from the side. Be controlled up. Helm of the Dominator. Yeah, it's actually belonging to COASO. And Ryze will be like, sweet! Free creep! Helm of the Dominator is still on cooldown for another 10 seconds. Ace. Oh, yes, again. Again. Steph Star will TP out safely this time around. The second time now. First time, it was Crit who blocked him with Familiars. This time, it's the Centaur that blocks it from Ryze.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
How long an extra Roshan timer too? Not long, only 30 seconds left to go. And we'll have Batrider as well in the middle of this. Farming up, 4 staff, Blink Dagger, Tranquil Boots. COASO. Well, Lifesteal is not a bad thing for him. He's got some good DPS coming out, but he still needs a little bit more. That's why I thought he was going to go for, like, the Crit of the Desolator. At this point, not looking great.
Boom, there it goes.
There's a rocket scouting out for Roshan, but Mousesports directly on there. The second he respawns, they go for him. But, at the same time, property, they're ready for this one. Observer wards go down. They're going to know they're inside the pit. Clockwork latches up. The cogs have to go as well. And now Link throws the ulti, but he's forced up on top of the cliff. Now, I'm not quite sure if there's actually a better position for him. He's got to get himself down from there. But there's no forced up to help him out of this one. He has to TP over to the tier 2 tower instead to get back in this fight. The Cinderin decides to take without popping his BKB. And he may. No, he doesn't trigger at the last moment. Soul Assumption will give a double kill here for Crit. COASO's ulti will pop, and Link losing a lot of life points here. Another Soul Assumption to Frigga Elite, and Chance slowing him down as well. The Impanis is really going to work here for Ryze. But Cinderin crazily going into that fight without triggering his BKB as well, which means probably just turned on him and nailed him down. But now with, well, SF injured and backing up, he's going to get a regeneration rune. He still can't get in there and contest it. Troll Warlord ulti or not. There should be a Sentry Ward down here from Mousesports, but they're not using it.
Roshan has fallen to the dire.
In fact, they don't have one, so yeah. The Medusa will pick up the Aegis the Immortal. Cinderin didn't have to, but he did buy back after that fight too. So he just lost a lot of money. You see his net worth just drop. He's in a fourth position now. He's being out net worth by both the Troll as well as the SF. And the push will come down the middle lane. Split shot it up. And just pressure towards the tier 3 tower. And again, jump in straight up. And we've got Vanguard. We've got Club up on Ace. Anything allows him to live after he jumps in up against that SF. But Mousesports aren't feeling confident enough to go high ground just yet. And now there's a second BKB over from Phloxplox. They really do have a lot to play around with here, property. Sefsal's initiation. Well, he's building it. He can afford drums. He'll have to sacrifice his buyback if he wants it, though. There we go. Chrysalis up for CYSO. So that damage I was looking for. It was going to be Chrysalis or it was going to be Desolator. It was one of the two. And having the option of having the Daedalus into the later portion of the game, combining up with Satanic. Something he's looking at probably a little bit more than just having the negative armor and the ability to get rid of those towers quickly when they do push out. That's still something which Mousesports have over property. But the gold advantage is still going to be Mousesports' way because they still hold the tower advantage. It's a 4-tower advantage before, as opposed to when I mentioned it last time, which was only 3 towers. And the experience, 3,000 for a 30-minute game, is negligible. It's easy to come back from. And it's just if you're able to get the rest of the space. Like, if you can push out and get a kill and then take the other towers, all that money comes back again. The experience is just going to be from getting kills, and you've got a Batrider to do all that kind of jazz. And also a Batrider building into a BKB. Funny though, the building into BKBs when you're going to be looking at a lot of physical DPS coming out from the Medusa. It goes back to the top lane right now. Might have to look towards BTs up on Link shortly. With 2600 gold too, Link. Next item coming up. Had a very large question mark over that. I still kind of want to see the Skadi up on him. Just the overall huge amounts of stats. Alright, we're good to go. Alright, so property, backing themselves up. We go into this stalemate right now. As both teams just want to farm up. We got Nag and Imceptor coming up for the Enchantress, taking a sweet ass time to get there. While DK trying to farm it towards an Assault Cuirass. Syndrome's a long way away from having that though. Buyback really did hurt him on that front. And Ace, like, it's like you want to go ganking. He might be considering just not going into a BKB here. I'm pretty sure though he wants to try and evade out for a lot of the stunts and the control which is coming out from property, not to mention the burst raise damage which comes out from the SF. So he could be looking at the Aghanim Scepter instead. And that just means consistent hooking all the time. But CYSO, they're happy to sit back. Like, their SF's getting some really good farm here. DK is able to top out the Troll Warlord again, but Troll Warlord is just kind of waiting for it. And it looks like, okay, Mousesports aren't happy to wait. They want to push in right now. Well, Frost Attack. That's just Ryze getting really desperate for a creep. But they're going to push in. Link to the front lines. He'll go Butterfly next item. Okay. First raise. Link very minimal damage. They've got Frost Dragon as well up from Cinderin. Fortification is available for the Radiant side, and they will be using it after their creep wave goes down here. Gonna buy themselves some time, or will they? Blink, Lasso, Dragon Syndrome back, Clockwork jumping in, but now also Medusa puts them all to stone. Ace in the middle of this fight, Syndrome, he's so low on life. One shot is keeping him only just barely alive. And with Soul Assumption damage, crits in the middle of this fight. There's gonna be a triple kill for the Visage. Familiar's working completely overtime. And SF finally wants to get rid of him, but they'll just be resummoned up by crit. Link in the split shot. But look for another Soul Assumption a moment over towards Devstar. The Impetus damage as well. There's your Soul Assumption. The Spy Carapace gives him a little bit of extra survivability. But the top racks will be taken out here by Mousesports.
Radiant's top barracks are under attack.
That is a totally toast.
Radiant's top barracks has fallen.
But they'll bail themselves out in property. Well, they're in a really, really rough position now. A lot of kills going the way of Mousesports during that engagement. And more importantly, they lost hardly anything. That clockwork went down. Whoopity-doo-da. Doesn't really matter when you got Link still alive, and when he takes this Ancient 2, full Butterfly, now going to fly out from the Courier. Full Aghanim Scepter as well coming out for Ryze. The Courier goes backwards just to pick up the rest of it. And now it can come out. So we've got Aghanim Scepter and a Butterfly appearing from Mousesports. Roshan's still a while off, so the Aegis Immortal never even triggered from Link during that fight. You see the time to have it reclaimed. And he's going to pop a Haste Room. He's searching for Werner. Werner, he's got Blink Dagger as well as Forced Up. Oh, hoy! He blinks into the middle of Mousesports. He wanted to go farming. Forced Up, he's going to get down the cliff with the Soul Assumption damage and the Impetus. He lassoed at the very, very last moment with the Batrider down. Mousesports will push out the bottom lane. They can lose a tier 2 tower. There's no problem with this whatsoever. In fact, they should lose it. Just let the Troll Warlord try and pressure out the middle lane. Use Fortification to slow him down, but attack on the Rax. Because then you get Split Rax. And Split Rax up against this Mousesports lineup, who will just 5-man push out the middle lane directly after. There's no problem whatsoever. Sure, they've lost the Aegis Immortal, but they've got Evasion now up on the Medusa to combine up with already a shield. Yeah, there goes the Fortification. Their Creep Wave comes in. Cinder into Dragon form. They know their trade-off is a lot better here. Link even just splitting him to Split Shot for a moment. And then back to the Focus Fire. Looking mainly at that tower to go down. Now it's gone. Focus on the melee racks. Everybody is back now for property. They claim the tier 2 tower in the mid. It's a full deadless in the hands of the SF. And he'll need every single crit to come out right now. But the range racks are going to go down. And Mousesports, it is full on safety first. The Assault Cuirass got finished up. No. They say, why safety first? Let's go back in again, guys. They can force fights. Batrider's Firefly is halfway through its time now. He's still got the... Well, she doesn't have the Blink Dagger. So he used it to escape back out again. But they rotate out. Cinderin should have already brought out the Courier. No, I'm picking on Cinderin tonight. There we go. Now his AC's flying. Observer Wars must have been waiting for that for crit. So they can at least see inside the base. And the last ditch effort now for property. This is all or nothing. Either they get the perfect pick off. No, they will. They'll find crit. Crit should die right now. It's got 2-1 charges. Not enough to survive. Go Scepter. Makes life a little bit harder, but then SF just says, oh, I have a raise. 635 gold going his way now too, as well as picking up both familiars. With no option for a resummon either. But with the Split Rax, they're already really fighting up against a huge wave of momentum for Mousesports. Getting that kill on Visage just relieves the pressure for a little bit. Mousesports will wait it out. Got another minute and a half before Roshan's going to spawn up with an Aegis as well as a Cheese. And at that moment, they will. They will just 5-man and push mid. But that also means that they're going to be predictable of where they're going to be. So if property... They probably will know this. They should know the timing of Roshan. It's like 1 minute and 10, 1 minute 15 seconds now. Left on the clock. Ace is desperately... So he is going to go build into a BKB. So he gets his BKB before the fight. Not a bad item to have. Link. If he gets caught out right now, even better. Forced off used to trigger the Lincoln Sphere of Link. And now they go into the Whirling Axis. Link, he has to use the ulti. He has no other choice. It was the only way he's going to escape from that fight. And while they chase him, those tier 4 towers are being attacked. The top lane momentum's really coming in. Yeah, the TP has to come back. That's the SF on the way in. We'll clean up the top with a couple of raises and just some right clicks. Okay, 3 raises instead. Not a single right click was given. But that means he also just TP'd back when Roshan now, 20 seconds away from spawning. And Werner just put his Firefly on cooldown for another 23 seconds. This was just so he could push out the lane. But they've got to group up together and smoke out. Mousesports probably will also be aware of this. So they'll try and come in just a little bit later. Or at least have some... Like, where are your wards? I see a sentry. That one's going to be planted basically right here in the middle of the river. Watch him come in. You've already got 2 invis heroes that are looking to just to jump in. And Ace is using his rocket, in fact, to scout out. So they're all grouped up. Sentry wards. Making sure there's no observer wards inside the base, which there is not. But Mousesports are waiting for him. Roshan hasn't been started. The lanes are still going to push in for Mousesports. They are not under pressure to fight this. In fact, the place they want to fight from here, you see him. They want to hold this high ground right here. They stay on the upside of this, and they're looking good. And they're going to loop around. Nice. Very smart play here by Prop. And they got one. They find Crit. Drag him back. And they want him dead before this fight begins. BKBs will now start triggering off. And that is going to actually allow Crit. He went down to 8 HP. The stun won't hit. The flame break as well. The Enchantress heals, keeping Crit alive through all of this. The clockwork went down. DK as well. There was a lot of damage to be dealt out by the SF. But finally, he will be brought down as well by the Enchantress. And Freak Elite hiding in the corner. He'll frostbite up Riot. He can't get the kill. This is GG. You've got the tier 4 towers being brought down. In fact, there it is, the call out by Frig Elite. When they was having a look and said, well, they never even started Roshan. It is a full GG, well played. The win goes to Mousesports. The Mousesports will return tomorrow to battle it out against the winner of our next matchup, be it Team Empire or Power Rangers, to play in the winner's bracket final. Winner of that qualifies himself for the LAN final for the RaidCall EMS One Fall season, which is to be played out, I believe, in December this year. So, should be good times for that one. In the meantime, stay tuned, people. We've got a big game coming up. Power Rangers going up against Team Empire will be your next matchup here right on the live stream. So stay tuned. We'll be back here in just a moment.